within. While walking in the light of God, I sweet communion find. How for the hurrying around and leave the world behind. Sunlight, sunlight in my soul today. Sunlight, sunlight all along the way. Since the Savior found me, took away my sin, I have had the sunlight of His love within. I cross the wide extended fields, I journey o'er the plain, and in the sunlight of I reap the golden grain. Sunlight, sunlight in my soul today. Sunlight, sunlight all along the way. Since the Savior found me, took away my sin, I have had the sunlight of His love within. Soon I shall see Him as He is, the light that came to me. Behold the brightness of His face throughout eternity. Sunlight, sunlight in my soul today.
Thank y'all very much. Choir, you can be seated. Brother Rick, you want to come on up? Just Rick.
I'm going to sing a song for y'all. It's called, When He Sees Me, He Sees the Blood of the Lamb. That's AFAC.
I know.
The concept behind that song is the idea of what we call substitutionary righteousness, right? Substitutionary righteousness. It says that Jesus took our place and we have the attribute of his righteousness added unto us. I have trouble getting that through to a lot of believers because most folks want to feel like they've got some goodness of their self, some sort of righteousness in them, there's some seed of goodness in mankind, and the Bible tells us just the opposite of that, that there's none righteous, no, not one, none righteous. We're altogether unworthy. We are desperately wicked. The only righteousness that we have is his righteousness. But by the way, that's the only righteousness that counts, amen, is his righteousness. And I love the doctrine of that song. Now, Miss Diane is watching tonight, and she wants to give praise to God because of the nurses and the angels. She said that that made the scariness leave, was calmed down, I guess, in the operating room, and we're grateful for that. I wanted to read to you some of our prayer requests and praise reports tonight. Miss Adrian told me about a young 13-year-old boy that had an automobile, that was in an automobile accident several weeks ago, and he had a brain bleed. And he passed away today. One of the children from Callahan was a middle schooler just last year and then passed away this year. So remember Tucker O'Shields' family. That was the young boy's name. And, of course, we told you about Miss Diane and Brother Mike Bailey preparing to go down to Gainesville in the morning for his surgery. He's already been twice here in Jacksonville. And they haven't been able to do it for one reason or another. We're praying that the third time is the charm. So y'all be praying for Brother Mike. Brother Garnett come to me just before service tonight, and his grandson Gabe is at the ER. They haven't heard what it is yet. He's being checked out. They're thinking maybe possible dehydration or something of that nature. Y'all pray for Gabe that God would touch him. Of course, Raymond Bass and the surgeries that he's scheduled for. And then Austin's dad, this is Brianna's boyfriend, his name is Jeff, went into surgery today for his cancer. So y'all remember Jeff in your prayer. 10 hours later, he's still there. Oh, my goodness. Okay. And then Brother Mike Cox, this is Brother Wade's dad, had his ablation yesterday and is recovering, doing well, but the anesthesia has thrown him some complications, and y'all pray for him. So I just wanted to pass those things on to you, Brother Frank.
King Road Baptist Church.
Oh, yeah.
Having a memorial service for Brother James Strong. Saturday at 4 p.m.
My goodness. I'm telling you something, Wayne. We have there's something wrong in our nation. There's a spirit of wickedness and violence that has gripped our country. We gotta pray. That's right. We gotta pray. Now listen, I wanna say something to you. Don't want you to be offended by it. We can think it's all about them. But you read scripture. Anywhere you want to read it, any one of these preachers will back me up if they know what they're talking about. And listen to this. God always calls on us to repent, to bring our nation back. We are responsible. God's people are responsible. Yeah. We can't expect the ungodly to know how to deal with God. It has to be our responsibility. He said, if my people,
that's right,
which are called by my name. Right? It's not talking. So, I mean, we can say, look at the unrest, look at the wickedness, and we need to pray that the country will come back to God. We need to pray that God's people will come back to God.
Amen. That's,
and we get our hearts right. Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Dylan's doing great. That's fantastic. Is there anyone else? Yes, ma'am. Absolutely. Hurricane violence is terrible. Yes, brother. That's got to be tough. Yeah, that's got to be tough. Amen. Amen. Is there any others real quick? A piece of good news. I thought about it as I looked back and saw Adam. I talked with Adam. When did we talk? Was it last Sunday about baptism? It was Sunday. Adam had spoke with me. He said, I need to talk to you about something. And anyway, he asked me about baptism. I said, you haven't been baptized? And he said, no. I said, you have been born again. You're a believer. And we talked about that. He's, yes, sir, absolutely. And so he is ready for baptism. We're going to do that by next first Sunday. 6th, I think I told you, right? And so I'm another piece of good news. I love seeing folks come to the Lord, folks getting baptized. I love to see folks at the altar. I love to see folks rededicate. Love to see the fact that God's people, Lord, are getting in line. I love that. And man, like I said, we got to come back to Him and He will bless our nation. I believe that with all my heart. I want to reiterate to you something I said to you this past Sunday. If you are not a registered voter, please get registered. You can do that online. Is that correct, Adrian? Is registration online? Registration is, you can do that on the line. And you can get registered. And then make sure that you vote. I was talking with some of my family today, and they said that they are registered, but they didn't vote. And I said, well, please make sure you don't overlook it this time. And I want to encourage you to encourage your families to do the same. And so I just want to make sure that I pass that on to you. We're going to pray, and then Brother Charles is bringing the message tonight. And we've been praying for him. We prayed for him all up and down that hallway. So he ought to be ready to go. So if he preaches long, it's Brother David's fault. We're going to pray now. We're going to pray for these prayer requests that God will just take care of it all. Are you ready? Will y'all help me tonight? Fathers, we bow before you. We ask, God, that you would touch in these lives. God, we know that the issue of prayer is the greatest weapon that a Christian can possess. Lord, we reach the throne of heaven with our prayers. You tell us in your word that the effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. It moves God to do his will and to move into lives of men and women on this earth. So, Lord, we bring before you the Tucker O'Shields family. Lord, this young boy that passed away from this accident so many weeks ago, and we ask God you keep your hand upon them. I know they must be asking all kind of questions about how this could be, but God, for your honor and your glory, I pray that you'd move into that family, and Lord, let them feel your comfort and your peace in their time of trouble. For Miss Diane, I ask God you continue with her recovery. It's going to be a long, hard road for her and her as she works through rehab and the recovery from the surgery. We thank you that the surgery went well. We ask for Brother Mike Bailey and his surgery tomorrow. Lord, he's already been up to bat twice, and they have sent him back. And I pray, dear Lord, that this time it will be a wonderful, wonderful outcome. We ask, God, for special grace upon Brother Mike and Miss Ramona tomorrow. For Gabe, who is at the ER tonight, we ask, God, that you would be with him, touch, and may they just find that all they need to give him is some fluids maybe and send him home, and he'll be just fine. I pray, God, for that child to be strong and running about the house again. For our schools, all of our schools are facing this virus that is now encapsulated in the classrooms and on the buses. And Lord, I pray, God, that you would be with our children and the teachers and the admin staff and drivers and all of the folks that are involved with any aspect of our schools. God, keep your hand upon them. We have to come back. Just as Brother TJ talked about the nursing homes, this is a necessary step. It's got to happen sometime. And I pray, God, that you would give us the guidance and the unction at the time when it's time. Let us do it properly and safely. But God, let us do it. Let us do it, that we might reach those, Lord. I pray, God, that you keep your hand upon us. For Brother Raymond, pray, God, your mercy upon him in his surgery. And I got to get the infection down, I think, before they can actually do it. For Austin's dad, Jeff, Lord, I'm familiar. Brother Rick just let us know that he was made aware that Jeff's still in surgery 10 hours now. And, Lord, I know that that's gone longer than they anticipated. So, Lord, our hearts sink a bit, but, Lord, our hope is in you. And we ask, God, you continue to just be with Jeff, and we pray, God, you'd bring him through it. Brother Mike Cox, we thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to be able to worship with him lately, and we ask, God, for his strong recovery. I pray, dear Heavenly Father, for the folks that will be attending Brother James Schrantz's memorial service. We ask, God, your hands upon them and the family and around all the friends. I ask, God, you keep your hand on them. We thank you that Dylan is doing good after that accident. We bring to you Brother James's niece and their family, as they've got to make a decision to turn off the machine. They've already decided that's what they're going to do tomorrow, and they're going to let their loved one just slip on into eternity, which I believe, God, that has probably already taken place. And but Lord, they're going to end the keeping the body going. I pray, dear Heavenly Father, that you'd be with that family. Now bless those that are in the path of the hurricane that is about to make landfall. They are talking it will be a Category 4, maybe by the time it becomes ashore, with strong winds and a large surge of water. I pray, God, that you'd keep your hand upon those folks. Lord, those that are living on the coast, I pray that they have the good sense and the opportunity to evacuate and forget about the material things and to keep themselves safe. I pray, Lord, for our country. In closing tonight, Lord, this prayer, I pray for our country. God, the United States of America, a country that was founded on religious principles. Lord, that is to hold up the concept of the fact that we have freedom and liberty to worship as we see fit. Lord, we're living now in a country where that is under attack, openly under attack. Lord, it's just obvious to us that there are some that have come against that one particular freedom or privilege. And so, Lord, we stand strong in our faith. Lord, we stand committed to our country. And Lord, most of all, we stay trusting in our God. We ask for your help now, as we know that we must return back to whence we left. We need to come back to live in truth. We need to stand back in the place where right is right and wrong is wrong. And you can tell the life of a Christian different from the life of a non-believer. God, we want to be clear cut in our following of you so that our nation will be blessed. Now I ask, dear Heavenly Father, you'd bless Brother Charles tonight as he comes to bring us the Word of God. We'll give you glory and we'll give you praise and honor. In Jesus' holy name we ask it. Amen. Brother Charles, if you'll come, my friend. Yes, ma'am.
Yes. made a comment a while back that I'm here to stir up your mind. Okay? I'm not here to make anybody happy except the Lord. I'm not here to put anybody down. But I'm here to do what God wants me to do. And that's to stir up your pure mind. Okay? And as we went into prayer here, I was there on the bench, and the Lord spoke to me and he said, "Why are you sitting here? Why aren't you on your knees?" And I remember what Brother Buddy had said Sunday. We have altars.
Yes, we do, brother.
We don't use them.
Bless
you, Lord. Yes. How many would get mad here if we just took them out?
Amen.
How many people would it upset?
Yes, sir.
You know?
Yes,
sir. That's all I'm going to say on that. Okay?
Come on.
I just want to thank the Lord tonight for all the things he's done for me.
Yes.
And all the things I know he's going to do for me.
Amen.
And I just want to say, the night of the sing, I gave a little brag out to the Lord what he did for me and my family one time when we was down and out.
Yeah.
And I know what he does for me, he'll do for everybody, anybody else.
That's right.
I'm nothing special.
Amen.
Nothing special here. But I just like to give a brag on God.
Amen.
What he does. And in these prayers, you know, me and the wife, through the years, have met quite a few people. And there is this lady, a preacher's wife, and she had breast cancer. The doctor said the tumor was the size of an egg. All right? She went to the hospital. They was going to do surgery. And she said, "Wait one more day, please, so my church can pray one more time."
Right.
The next morning, they came in, and the doctor was going to mark with their pen where they're going to operate and so forth, and he couldn't find it in his exam. So they sent her down for whatever it is women have, and it wasn't there no more. It was gone. Now, this thing was the size of an egg. This is what God can do, people. We need to take it serious when we are asked to pray for somebody.
Amen.
You know, take it serious. So, because God will hear, as Brother Buddy said, he asks us to pray.
That's right. That's right.
Not the world out there, because the world doesn't know.
They don't,
they don't know God.
No, they don't. Come on now, Charles.
They don't know him. How can they pray?
That's right.
The only thing they can pray is when he tugs on their heartstring, when he calls them, just like when he called me, that's when he heard my prayer. That prayer of repentance, that prayer of yes, Lord, I hear you. I want to be with you. I want what you want for me.
Amen. So true.
So tonight, if you have your Bibles, if you'll turn to the book of Numbers, chapter 21. But God, he's everything.
Amen.
You know, he's everything. And these scriptures, as I was reading them and looking at them, I just kept thinking, you know, it's so relevant to where we are today and the things we do today, yet they were written thousands of years ago.
Amen.
At the beginning, almost. When he brought his people out of Israel, the great things he did for them, and yet they still let the flesh come in. So, and it's so true with us also. We're just going to read some verses here in chapter 21, starting with the first verse, and we're going to probably go down to the ninth verse. We might stop before we get there and then pick back up. And when King Arad The Canaanite which dwelt in the south heard tell that Israel came by the way of the spies. Then he fought against Israel and took some of them prisoner. And Israel vowed a vow unto the Lord and said, if thou wilt indeed deliver this people into my hand, then I will utterly destroy their cities. And the Lord hearkened to the voice of Israel and delivered up the Canaanites, and they utterly destroyed them and their cities. And he called the name of the place Hormah. And they journeyed from Mount Hor by the way of the Red Sea, and compassed the land of Emad, and the soul of the people was much discouraged because of the way. And the people spake against God and against Moses. Yeah. Wherefore have you brought us up out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? For there is no bread, neither is there any water, and our soul loatheth this light bread. Wow. God delivered them. God's delivered us.
Amen. Yes. Yes.
Amen. Yet we, like them, a lot of times, let our inner man rise up.
Yep.
You know, we're saved. I hope everybody here is saved. If you're not, we have altars.
That's right.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
If you're saved, which, like I said, I hope everybody is, and we start to murmur, and we start to, how do you say, get complacent, let's just say, and we get complacent where we're at, and we start talking and say, I wish the church would do this, I wish the church would do that, I wish this was this way, I wish that was that way, I wish brother so-and-so wouldn't sit there, or sister so-and-so wouldn't sit there, or they can't sing, they need to get out of the choir, they can't. All this murmuring, I'm not saying you're doing it, but it's those things. And when we do those things, we've done what? We've sinned.
Yes, we have.
We have sinned.
Come on.
And what separates us from Christ?
Sin.
Is sin.
Come on, brother. Amen.
Amen. And we no longer have a walk with him because there's sin between us and him.
Amen.
He saved us from that.
Amen.
But we have put something between us.
That's right.
We have to move it.
Come on,
right?
Okay? We have to get rid of that.
That's right.
Kick it out of our life.
Amen.
Send it down the road.
Come on, man.
Get out of here. Go away. I can't have you. Because if I have you, I can't have Christ.
Amen. That's it.
We have to own the good.
Now, I'm not saying once saved, you can lose it. What I'm saying is, something comes between you and that spiritual walk. You have lost something.
Come on now.
The Bible tells us we're saved, and saved unto the good works of Jesus Christ.
That's right.
To do his works, not do my works.
That's right.
Not do the world's works.
Come on.
But to do his works.
Yep.
And when you put something between you and God, then you can't have that walk.
There you go.
You can't get right up next to him where he can put his arm around you and bless you. What did he do to these people? We read on down. And these people, he says here, I'm over here. And the Lord sent fiery serpents among the people. Ooh. And they bit the people, and much people of Israel died.
Right?
He sent fiery serpents to these people. You know, he might not send fiery serpents to us, but he puts things in the way.
Yeah, come on.
It could be worse.
He puts things there to turn us, to bring us back to him.
Right.
You know?
Yes.
Think about all the things in our lives that we know we shouldn't have had, and we had to give them up.
Yes.
Help us, Lord.
Give them up.
Give them up. So we can get back where we were with God.
That's good, brother. That's good right there, Deb. Thank you.
Not loving the things that we have accumulated, but loving God more.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yes.
The Bible says if we put him first
in everything,
all things will be added unto us.
Yes, that's right.
You know, you look at Job in our Sunday school class. We're in the book of Job.
Come on.
You look at Job. What happened to him? Not because he sinned, but because it was a test. We get tested. How are you going to stand? Are you going to fall to that test? I have.
Come on.
I'll tell you the truth. I'm only human. I failed miserably. I walked away for 14 years. But in that 14 years, I knew God was God. I knew he was the same. Yesterday, today, and forever. He doesn't change. We change. He doesn't. We desire our own will when we should be desiring his will. Stir that mind. Think of where we're at. Do what God has for us to do, not the things that we want. I thank God for the blessings that he gives me each and every day.
Amen.
Being able to get up and go to work.
Yeah.
Being able to witness to people. Being able to shine his light the best I can. I'm not perfect. I slip, I stumble, I fall. Got in an argument with a man a couple weeks ago at work. I had to go back to him.
Come on.
And apologize to him. Nothing bad was said, but it was an argument. It's not easy to step up and say when you firmly believe you weren't in the wrong, but God says, you got to change things with this man. How are you going to be a witness when this sitting out there?
Come on.
You can't be.
Come on now. That's right. Come on.
It's not easy to go back and say, hey, I'm sorry.
Yes.
I shouldn't have acted that way. I was wrong in doing so.
Yes. That's good, brother.
These people, they had these fiery serpents sent out there. That's a fiery serpent to me.
Oh, yes.
You know?
Yeah.
That thing bit me at the heart.
Come on now. Right.
I didn't want to do it.
Yep. Come on.
Many times, things come up to us and we know we should do, and we don't.
Come on now. That's good.
It's human nature. The Bible tells us we have to crucify this flesh daily.
Amen.
Not once a week.
Come on now.
Not once a month.
Yes, sir.
But daily.
That's right, bro.
Daily. Every day. We can't say, well, it's time to go to church, so I got to get up and go. They might be thinking bad if I don't show up. Well, if you think that way, you might as well stay home. Because you're going for the wrong reason. But if you get up because there's a burning in that heart to go worship God one more time in his house, to be where he wants us to be, joined together, fitly joined.
That's right.
We're part of the body of Christ. He says we're to be fitly joined. You know? How can we be fitly joined, Frank, if you go this way and I go that way, and we're constantly doing butting our heads together because we disagree so much? How can we be fitly joined?
Good.
How can we be fitly joined when we have three or four different Bibles in the church?
Yeah. Somebody's wrong. That's right.
I love this church. I love Brother Buddy because he stands for the King James Version.
Come on, that's right. Bless you, brother.
People say, well, it's a translation. And I say, yes, you're right. It's a translation. But all the scholars, and I'll tell you, it's the closest translation you're going to get.
Come on, that's right.
I can't read Hebrew. I don't know about you. But... so we go with this. I've read some of the others, and they don't match up. They just don't match up.
Don't have the strength or the power.
We have to be, when we sin, when we do things, and we go against what God, we got to do something.
Yes, come on.
And here, Therefore, the people came to Moses, seventh verse, and said, "We have sinned, for we have spoken against the Lord and against thee. Pray unto the Lord that he take away the serpents from us." And Moses prayed for the people.
Interceded,
exactly right.
Hallelujah.
Just like when someone comes to you with a prayer request, and you pray, you're interceding. You're bringing that to God. We, as Christian people, it shouldn't matter to us where we're at. You know, I got a phone call today. Pray for us on the prayer chain. I'm standing in the middle of my shop. And guess what? Before I prayed, is anybody looking?
Come on.
Hmm?
It shouldn't have mattered.
Huh? But I'm human.
Come on, Charles.
Okay?
Amen, Charles.
I prayed. I never should have looked around to see if somebody was there. Yes. It shouldn't have mattered. That thought shouldn't have come into my head.
Bless him. That's right.
But it did.
Yeah.
And how many times, how many people has that thought and there be somebody there and they walk away and go around the corner where nobody's at? How is that a witness? But when they see you standing amongst them and you're standing there with God, praising him, thanking him for touching somebody, asking him to move and do a miracle.
That's a good word. Amen. Come on.
Right. One of my bosses a few years ago, and I testified to it, and this is another praise unto him, not a praise unto me. But his wife was diagnosed with cancer. They went and got a second opinion. It come back the same. He went and got a third opinion. It came back the same. And they was always telling him, "You need to take her to the cancer specialist down there in Tampa." So he comes and he says, "Well, I won't be here the next few days. Headed to Tampa with my wife to the cancer specialist." And I had told him, "Well, I'm going to bring this to the church, put her on the prayer chain at the church." Guess what? I forgot. I forgot to do it. Totally slipped my mind until he said something that morning.
Wow.
And the Lord said, just as plain as he was speaking, he said, "Tell him not to be surprised when he gets to Tampa."
Okay.
So I told him that.
Thank you, Lord. Amen.
You know?
Thank you, Lord. Thank
I said, "When you get to Tampa, they're going to tell you she don't have cancer." Because that's what God told me. I'm nothing special. Because I done let it down. I didn't ask people to pray. As far as I know, nobody prayed.
Come on.
Because I totally forgot about it completely.
God didn't forget it. Come on.
He gets to Tampa, and he's back at work the next day. He's supposed to be down there all week. And he looks at me and he says, "You're psychic." I said, "No, I'm not." I said, "God knows all." You know, they told him, "What are those doctors up there doing?" He said, she don't have no cancer, ain't got no sign of cancer. Why God do it for one person and for the next, I don't know. But I do know this, God can do it. God will do it. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. He doesn't change. We change. To me, that's the greatest witness, because I was nowhere in it. Nobody could look at me and say, "Hey, he prayed." Because
I forgot. Yeah, amen. Hallelujah, brother. God bless you.
But God doesn't.
God don't forget.
He never forgets. He can never lie.
Yep. Doesn't make mistakes.
Exactly. He don't make no mistakes.
Come on now.
Every child born is exactly the way God wants them.
Come on now.
You know? There's no wrong with God.
Come on now.
It's impossible. He's all. Let's see. And Moses said and the Lord said unto Moses, take thee a fiery serpent, make thee a fiery serpent, and set it upon a pole, and it shall come to pass that everyone that is bitten, when he looketh upon it, shall live. And Moses made a serpent of brass and put it upon a pole, and it came to pass that if a serpent had bit any man, when he beheld the serpent of brass, he lived.
Amen. What about that?
Exactly.
Amen.
What about that? So when these things come against us, when the serpents of this world is biting you and injecting their venom in you and pulling you down and telling you you shouldn't go to church, you need to change, you need to be like us. I hear all this stuff. It's trying to pull you down. It's trying to keep you away from God. It's trying to separate us from God. We need to kick that out so that we can have that walk that God wants us to have with Him. Okay? He wants us
all the time.
Just like that. Just like that with Him. Not like this. Not like how do you show your wife or your girlfriend that you love them? You get close to them, especially when you're courting them. That's an old word, isn't it? Court. Showing my age. You know, you get close to them. You honey up to them. You know, you want to be sitting right next to them. You know. You're in the car and they're in the front seat. They're not on the passenger side. They're right there in the middle.
Yep.
Right where you want them. Right next to them. You don't want anything between you. Especially not another guy.
Yep.
So why do we want to put the devil between us and God?
Go ahead.
Hello.
Go ahead.
Stirring up that mind. You might throw me out of here. I don't know. But stirring up that mind.
Listen.
What's between you and God? You know?
Amen.
And if you turn over to John, ooh, I went way past John. Come on, I know you can. I didn't have John Mark, so. You go to John 3, and everybody knows John 3:16. But before, if we go to John, it reads here in chapter 14, chapter 3, verse 14. And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have eternal life.
Right.
Lift him up.
Yes, amen.
Put him number one.
That's right.
Lifted up. Not set on the side. Not closed up in the Bible. You pick it up once a week. I tell my boys in Sunday school, you need to read your word. You need to read every day. If you can't read every day,
recite something.
At least read once a week.
Come on now.
But I find the same answer from them. Well, I get to playing my game, and I forget, you know? It's a hard thing,
right?
You know? Our young people need a lot of prayer.
Yes.
You know? They need a lot of prayer.
Too many idle moments.
We got a wonderful group here of young people.
Amen.
We do. They come. They're faithful.
Yes.
When they can get away, they're here.
Thank
we need to pray for them. We need to uplift them.
Yes, congregation.
Not only them, but the ones that are there with them. I know it's my son and my daughter-in-law, but she's like a daughter to me. I call her my daughter. But and the ones that previously worked with them.
That's right.
The ones that came before.
Amen.
You know? We have to put Christ first.
Yes.
We can't let him have any space between us and him.
Not at all.
If we do, we're putting ourselves in jeopardy.
Yes, we are.
You know?
Right.
Because he's going to try to bring you back.
Come on now, Lord. Correct.
You know, when I did something wrong, I got a whipping.
Yeah.
I know Brother Buddy did. I've heard him say it.
Yes, I did.
You know? I got a whipping. And what was that whipping for? It's to bring me back around.
Yeah.
To straighten me out.
Amen.
To say, this is the way you should go.
Yes. Hallelujah.
Not there, but here.
Spare the
rod. You know?
Yeah.
How many times that I thought, oh man, I got this extra money and I'm going to go do this. And the next thing I know, it's gone.
Right?
Why?
Yeah.
Because what I was wanting to use it for was putting something between me and God.
Okay.
How many times, you know, we might stub our toe or we might get a cold and it's God's way of trying to bring us back to him.
Amen.
God's not going to punish you. He's not doing it for like a punishment, but he's doing it to bring you back, to remind you. He didn't send those serpents as punishment. If he did, he never would have said, make the brazen serpent.
Correction.
You know? They came to you, they asked prayer. Okay,
right.
Now they've repented.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I'm willing and loving and able to take care of their problem.
Amen.
So let's take care of that problem.
Hallelujah. Amen.
But who put the problem there? We put the problem there. He's going to take care of that problem. Once we realize we put the problem, they came to Moses and said, we talked bad about God. We murmured and we talked about you.
Yeah.
They realized it.
They came to themselves.
Yeah. And they said, pray for us.
Yep.
That God will do something. We know we sinned. We know we did wrong. When we get down on those knees at an altar, then we know when we talk to God, he turns that ear instead of just half-handedly. Well, Lord, I know I didn't do quite right, but you know, Lord, this was all Billy's fault. It wasn't mine. If he hadn't have done that, I wouldn't have done this. Come on. You know? The blame lies here. We control ourselves.
That's right.
You know, I control myself. God gave me free will. The devil can put that temptation there. He can say, there it is. Well, you know, I really like that. Wow. And there it is. It's within my grasp.
Blessing
you. Nobody will know.
Yep. Come on.
Nobody will know.
Who did it?
Come on.
He will know.
Who?
He always.
Who?
Two that know.
Or you can make the choice. You know, God delivered me from that.
Yes. Amen.
I'm not having anything to do with it.
Amen.
And go on about my business. I made a choice.
Come on. Now. Come
you
on.
Know? We make the choice. Whether it's the right choice or the wrong choice, but we made a choice. Because he gives that to us. He doesn't force us into anything. But if we have him in our heart, the love for him in our heart will guide us in the direction that he wants us to go. Brother Buddy was talking about righteousness imputed upon us.
Right.
What greater righteousness do we have than the Lord Jesus Christ? You know, all we got to do is look up to him.
Hallelujah.
Say, Lord, here am I.
There you go.
But a sinner, hear my prayer.
Yes, sir.
Help me. Help my brother. Help my sister.
Amen.
Don't kick them when they're down. I've been there. I've been on both sides of that, by the way.
Yeah, yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
I mentioned 14, 15, 16 years ago when I walked away, people kicked me a lot.
Sure.
You know, they didn't come to me and say, "Brother, let me help you back up. You need to come on back in." No. Yeah. I knew he'd be that way. I knew. Let's not be that way.
Come on.
Let's be the way God wants us to be.
Amen.
Amen. Stir up that pure mind.
Amen.
Think about the things in your life that shouldn't be there. Think about the things you put before God, no matter how small it might be. It's there.
Yeah.
You know, I had a little splinter in my finger. I couldn't even see it without the magnifying glass, but every time I touched something, I could feel it. Huh?
Right.
I could feel it.
That's good right there.
And that separated me from picking something up. I didn't want to pick something up.
Sure.
I said, "I picked that up, it's going to stick me." And so I'd reach with this hand.
Amen. Good point.
People, I love each and every one of you.
Hallelujah.
And I'll do anything for each and every one of you, as long as it doesn't go against God.
Yep.
If it's going to go against God, you're on your own.
Amen.
But God has put me here to stir up your mind.
Hallelujah.
To get you thinking. To get you to realize it's more to it than just being here.
Amen.
And as Brother Buddy said, these altars are always open.
Always. Amen.
You ain't got to wait on an altar call.
Yep.
Well, it don't matter who's up here. Me, Brother TJ, Brother Dan, Brother Wade, Brother Buddy. It doesn't matter. You feel a need, you get up and go. You've already said you wouldn't like it if they were taken out.
Right.
So, you know, we need to use them. God wants us to use them.
Amen.
You know, get out of our comfort zone.
Yes.
You ever hear that one?
Hallelujah.
Get out of your comfort zone.
Yep.
Comfort zone, you might can say, is the wrong zone. You know, in closing, let's just remember, I just use these verses kind of bring, you know, what God wants us to do. And there's that little bit of sin will separate you from what God wants you to be.
Amen.
You know?
That's right.
He's still there. He's waiting on you. He's waiting on me. So, his brother Buddy gets a song. Looks like he's got something on his mind.
Yes.
You gotta love it.
Amen.
You know, you gotta love God. He is just so great, and I thank Him.
Amen.
So.
Thank you. Amen, buddy. If you guys would stand with us, we're gonna
sing "Pass Me Not," 167. If you want to help, but I want to give you the opportunity tonight to do exactly what Brother Charles was preaching about, and that is turning our hearts back toward God.
As He has moved on us tonight through His holy word. Amen.
Pass me not, O gentle Savior. Hear my humble cry. While on others thou art me.
As you deal with those around us, I pray, God, you don't pass me by. Let my cry be heard by your precious, merciful ears. Lord, tonight in our prayer, I hold up Sister Annette Hatcher. Lord, Brother Tommy has made us aware that she has just had such a time over the past 8 months since her surgery that was botched. And now, Lord, she's got more procedures to go through. We ask God for a special touch there. And I ask God you'd be with her. I pray, Father, that you would anoint and bless the seed of the gospel from this message tonight into our hearts. Thank you for speaking to Brother Charles and him being faithful to give us the word. We ask God that it would just permeate into our souls. Let our old human nature step aside and let God have his way as we return back to the God who redeemed us and brought us out so that we might walk in that harmony that he was talking about tonight. Thank you for that message, and we give you praise, honor, and glory. In the name of Jesus, we ask it. Amen. For those of you tonight that would like to join us, we're going to have a party after church. It's a church cleaning party, that's right. So if you'd like to be a part of that, you can stay with us and help. If you are not the partying kind, we will see you on Sunday. Uh-oh. Oh. It is my prayer that you have heard from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ through something that was sung or preached or said. If God has touched you, then I would urge you that you surrender to him today without delay. If you've made a decision to trust Christ as your personal Savior, or maybe you have chosen to surrender to him more fully in his Lordship, then I would urge you to let us know by giving us a call at 904-924-8240, or you can email me at Pastor, P-A-S-T-O-R, at lrbcjax.org. Until next time, may God be richly blessing you.